Hello people, let's quickly revise IND AS 16 property plan and equipment with the help of our summary chart. Okay, first we saw exclusions. One exclusion is if you have any PPE held for sale. PPE held for sale will be accounted as per IND AS 105, so it will not get triggered here. If you have any biological assets, then it will be accounted as per IND AS 41, so this standard will not come. But one exception is bearer plant. For bearer plant, IND AS 16 very much applies. For other biological assets, IND AS 41 will get triggered. And if you have any exploration assets like mineral ores, coal, rice, etc., etc., then we have IND AS 106, so that gets triggered over there. So these are the exceptions. But one thing you have to probably keep in mind is if any PPE is used for above activities, then IND AS 16 will very much get applied. Meaning, sir, for biological assets as in living plants and animal, IND AS 41 is applicable. But if you have any tractor, that you are using for agricultural process, to grow a plant, to grow a crop, if you are using any tractor, etc., etc., for this tractor and all, no, IND AS 16 only will apply. For the crop, IND AS 41, agriculture will apply. But if you have any other assets that you are using, like other PPE that you are using, like tractor and all, IND AS 16 only very much applies. That's what I'm saying here. If any PPE is used for above activities, IND AS 16 only will apply. Okay, got it? That I think we had not discussed in class. Is this clear with you, everyone? Got it? Okay, next. Sir, if you want to call something as PPE, there are three characteristics. One, it should be a tangible asset. Okay. Asset means it's an economic resource controlled by the entity from which we will get all the benefits, substantial benefits, and restrict others from getting the benefit. So in order to call it as PPE, one, it should be a tangible asset. Two, it should be held for use. That usage could be either to produce goods or rendering service or administrative purpose or rental purpose. And the period of usage should be for more than one period, as in 12 months. Okay, this is the definition of PPE. But if you want to show PPE in balance sheet, there are two recognition criteria, FEB and cost measurement. Due to that asset, some future economic benefit should flow to the entity. Okay, and the cost of the asset should be measured reliably. This is your recognition criteria. Okay, and we discussed that for bearer plant, IND AS 16 is applicable. Bearer plant means what? It is a plant which satisfies three conditions. One, it should be used in the production or supply of agricultural produce. Two, it must bear the produce for more than 12 months. Three, it has a remote likelihood of being sold as agricultural produce except for incidental scrap sale. Meaning you should not sell that plant in the ordinary course of business we had discussed. Yes, no? So that is the pointer we have written here. All right, next. Cost. Initially, all the PPEs are recorded at cost. Cost for this purpose is what? Purchase cost. DAC and DSR. Purchase, DAC and DSR. DSR are brought in separately, I've written here. So under purchase cost, if you have any import duty and other non-refundable taxes, add it. If you have any trade discounts or rebate, reduce it. DAC means what? Those costs incurred to bring the PPE to the present location and to the present condition so that the asset can function in the way as intended by the management. Basically, DACs are those costs incurred to make the asset management ready to use. Okay, RDU stands for ready to use. Some of the examples of DAC I've given, site preparation, delivery, etc., etc. Testing charges also a DAC, but do keep in mind that if you have got any proceeds from the sale of that tested product, that you need to deduct. Whatever is the proceeds, deduct that. Okay, then some cost exclusions. Cost exclusions we already know. If they have any general administrative overheads, selling and distribution overheads, staff training cost, initial operating cost, relocation cost, reorganization cost, marketing cost, promotion cost, all these are excluded from the cost of PPE, meaning it will straight away go off to P&L. Okay, and I've also given here traveling cost, okay, cost prior to acquisition. This is a little dicey, you need to be careful. Sir, if a particular director of a company, let's say he's going to Japan to buy a machinery, there is a director of a company, he's going to Japan only to buy a machinery, then the traveling cost becomes DAC. Do you agree with me? A director is traveling to Japan to buy a machinery. That is the reason he has gone there. So that means that traveling cost becomes DAC. But, I've written this under cost exclusion. What am I trying to say here is, let's say director is already in Japan. Director has already gone to Japan. For some other purpose, he had gone. Then he thought, okay, let me also check about machinery. Let me also see what about this machinery. In that case, traveling cost is not DAC. It goes off to SPL. Are you getting the difference? He has already gone to Japan for some other work. Along with other work, he is looking at purchasing machinery also. If that is the case, means traveling cost is not a DAC, rather it will be transferred off to SPL. Are we comfortable? That I have pointed out here. Hope that meaning is clear for everyone. Did you get that point? Okay. And if you have any incidental operation, okay, so that incidental operation ka expense as well as income, both will be transferred off to SPL itself. Okay, great. Now, DSR cost. DSR cost, can you add it to PPE? Yes. Full DSR cost? No, only the present value of DSR cost you can add it. The difference between the total DSR total value and the present value is nothing but your time value of money ka interest charges or finance charges that will be transferred off to P&L account. Okay, meaning for DSR we make provision for DSR, but this provision is accounted as per IND AS 37 that talks about provision. Okay, and each year provision balance will slowly go on increasing. That's what we call it as interest table or amortization cost table. Okay, fair enough, that will get triggered. And one more point you need to keep in mind is if DSR cost relates to PPE, add it to the cost of PPE. However, if it relates to inventory, then you need to add it to the cost of inventory. I've given you an example, Reliance oil well example. DSR cost relating to that oil rig or oil well will be added to the PPE. But DSR cost relating to the extraction of oil will be added to the cost of inventory itself. That I've listed out over here. Okay. All right, next. All right. If you have made any additions to PPE, replacement parts or anything of that sort, okay? Then, if recognition criteria is met, add it to the cost of PPE. If it is not, transfer it off to P&L. Additions mean, okay? All right? Then, if you have any replaced any part of the asset, or if you have incurred any major inspection charges, then what? Then, the new cost of the new replacement cost and the major inspection charges, you add. But the carrying amount of the existing part, you have to de-recognize, okay? All right. Now, if you have purchased any spare parts, check again. If recognition criteria is met, okay, then you can add it to the cost of PPE. Else, it will be shown as inventory, okay? And simply, and here also, if you want to say, there's a clarification. If spare parts, if you have purchased along with PPE, then it will be added to the cost of PPE only. If you have purchased spare parts separately, then you can also treat it as a separate PPE also. There's some clarification given on this, okay? Now that it is tested often, I'm just giving there, okay? Any problem, anybody? In this, all right, this is a problem specific adjustment. You remember the turbine problem where the carrying amount of the existing turbine was not given. We found out. How did we find out? We used the new part ka cost. Okay, that was a future value. We used a discount factor and found out its original cost. That step I have written it here. There's a problem specific adjustment that I've written, a turbine wala problem. That just for your reference, I've written. All right, next, I think 1 second. Okay, next here. All right. If you have purchased PPE for any cash, is there any problem? No. So if you paid 10 lakh rupees and you purchased PPE, means the journal entry will be PPE account debit to cash or bank, that entry. Okay, that entry will come. If you purchase the PPE on a deferred credit basis, if you purchase PPE on a deferred credit basis, what do you have to do, sir? You have to record the PPE at a cash price equivalent. You have to record PPE at cash price equivalent. The difference between the transaction price and cash price equivalent is nothing but your time value of money ka interest charges that will go off to P&L account over the contract duration. We have done the problem. Then, if you purchase the PPE on an exchange terms, if you purchased on an exchange, then as a thumb rule, you have to use fair value. Fair value you need not use under two circumstances. One, if the transaction lacks commercial substance. I've written another way around. I'll discuss what we have discussed. Transaction lacks commercial substance, or fair value of the asset is not determinable. Both asset acquired ka and given up ka. And when do you say transaction lacks commercial substance? When asset-wise cash flow and entity-wise cash flow should be same. If both asset-wise cash flow and entity-wise cash flow, if it is same, we say transaction lacks commercial substance. Okay. All right. If you are not using fair value, then what will you use? Use carrying amount of the asset given up. Meaning, if you are using this, then no gain or loss will be accounted. Only if you are using fair value, then gain or loss accounting will come. Don't worry about this. This is related to IND AS 113 ka point that I brought it in here. We have not covered IND AS 113, so you don't have to worry about this. Once you do that, then you'll understand what is that all about. For now, time being, you can ignore that. If PPE is exchanged for monetary items, meaning you purchased a PPE, but you did not pay cash monetary item. You paid some other monetary item like debtors, bill receivable, etc., etc. You purchased a PPE and you gave off bill receivable, because bill receivable can be endorsed. You've studied all this. If you have done that, then it is treated like your purchase PPE for cash itself. Meaning, let's say you give bill receivable of 10 lakh rupees to purchase PPE. You give bill receivable of 10 lakh and purchase PPE. Then the journal entry you will pass is PPE account debit 10 lakh to bill receivable account 10 lakh. It is like treated. This bill receivable ka value itself becomes PPE ka value. This journal entry you will pass. That's what I've written here. Okay. Any problems? No. Okay. Next one. Self-constructed asset. For self-constructed asset, is there any extra drama, sir? No. Use the same principle of acquired asset. Okay. But some PPE, if you are producing for own use, and some PPE, if you are producing it to be sold in the ordinary course of business, something which is sold in the ordinary course of business, will you call it as PPE or it becomes inventory? It becomes inventory. Okay. So these two, will you manufacture separately? No, probably you'll manufacture together. To manufacture these goods, you'll incur some cost, no? That cost itself can be treated as PPE own usage ka cost. Whatever cost is of the inventory produced, that only can be treated as cost of self-constructed asset, which you are using it for own purpose. Okay? All right. And if you are any constructing the asset, no, there's a disclosure standard. Okay? If you're constructing any asset, let's say you're constructing a building, will the construction be completed within 1 year, or it may take more than 1 year also? It may take more than 1 year also. Yes, no? Suppose it takes 1.5 years. Okay? That building, can you right now show it as PPE? You started the construction in year one. It'll be completed only in the second year. First year only, can you show it as PPE? No. You have to show that as a capital work in progress. In your balance sheet, there is a category called capital work in progress. There you have to show. Till the asset is ready for use, it will be in capital work in progress ka category. Once the asset becomes ready to use, then from capital work in progress category, it will be shifted to PPE ka category. That's what I've written here. This is more like the other chapter ka topics, but I thought I'll just bring it in here only. This will all be there later. Okay? Fair enough, everybody? Okay. If you have given any advance for construction, then you cannot treat that as capital work in progress. Okay? Suppose you are constructing a building. Okay, before construction only, you gave some advance. That advance, do not show it as capital work in progress. Advance, you show it as an advance only. You show advance as an advance only. Do not show it as capital work in progress. Only when the work starts, that cost only, you show it as capital work in progress I've brought in. Okay, fair enough. And then depreciation of own equipment to be own equipment used in construction to be added. I gave you bulldozer example. Remember, you are constructing a building, and you use bulldozer to construct the building. That means bulldozer ka depreciation, will you transfer it to SPL or it'll be treated as DAC? It'll be treated as DAC and added to the cost of PPE. That's what I've written here. Okay? Alright. Next is depreciation. Sir, you will charge depreciation only if two criteria get triggered. One, DA should be positive and useful life should be limited. Yes, no? Only for those assets which satisfies these two criteria, depreciation will come. Others, it will not come. Okay? And depreciation will start from the day asset is ready to use or available for use. Put to use is irrelevant for depreciation. Okay, and depreciable amount should be allocated on a systematic basis over the useful life of the asset. All right, if you have a different components, if a particular asset has different components, okay, then and each component if it has different useful life, then for each part you need to calculate depreciation separately. This is your component accounting we used to call. That is what I brought in here. Okay, then how do you choose depreciation method? The depreciation method that you choose should reflect the pattern of economic benefits that you get from the asset. If you're getting same pattern of benefits, then you can use straight line method, etc., etc. Okay? All right. If usage method is adopted, I also told, no, you can follow usage method, units of production method as depreciation. If usage method is adopted, then no depreciation is charged if PPE is not used. If any particular months may, if you're not using PPE, and if you're following usage method of depreciation, since you have not used the asset, depreciation for that period also will not come. Okay? Alright. Can you charge depreciation based on revenue, sir? No. Depreciation method based on revenue is not relevant because revenue is not just influenced by PPE. It is influenced by other factors also, like price of the product, quality of the product, economic conditions, competitor action, etc., etc. That's the reason. Alright. So, land and building are separate property, plan and equipment. So, if they have given land and building together, you will have to separate it. On land portion, you will not account any depreciation. For building portion, you account depreciation. On land, we don't charge depreciation because land has unlimited useful life. So, every year, no, three things you need to check. One is the useful life of the asset you just check. Residual value of the asset also you just check. useful life, residual value. Go on, check. And also pattern of economic benefits. These three you have to assess every year. If there is a change in any of these, if any of this has changed, then it will be treated as what, sir? Accounting policy change or accounting estimate change? Any change in useful life, depreciation method, residual value and all is treated as an accounting estimate change. And estimate change are always done what? Prospectively, meaning from that day onwards, this change is accounted, not before that. Earlier period, whatever depreciation you have charged, let it be as it is. Okay. And I've written an equation over here. If fair value is greater than the cost of the asset, will you still charge depreciation? Very much yes. Fair value is irrelevant as far as depreciation goes. For depreciation, our main funda is what, sir? The carrying amount and residual value. If residual value is greater than or equal to carrying amount, if it is greater than or equal to carrying amount, then depreciable amount is either zero or it becomes negative. If residual value is greater than carrying amount, then DA will become negative. If residual value is equal to carrying amount, means depreciable amount is zero. So in that case, depreciation will not come. And how do you calculate DA? Depreciable amount is nothing but your carrying amount minus residual value. This should be positive. This DA should be positive for you to calculate depreciation. If asset is held for sale, then will depreciation come? No. Depreciation, in fact, will cease to exit. You will stop depreciation at earliest of two dates. One, either when the asset becomes held for sale or the asset has got derecognized. Whichever has come early, that is the date, on the earliest date, the depreciation will stop. Okay. All right. I have already written this. Okay. Next, we looked at revaluation. Okay. Initially, PPEs are recorded at cost. Subsequently, either you can go for cost model or revaluation model. Changing from cost model to revaluation model. These are accounting policies. Any change in them is treated as a change in accounting policies, and we do retrospective accounting for these. Okay. And company has a choice to whether go for cost model or revaluation model. If company wants to go for revaluation model, first of all, revaluation means to show the asset at its fair value. If you want to go for revaluation, then the entire class of PPE should be revalued. Class means that group of assets which have similar characteristics with respect to their nature, size, usage, benefits, etc., etc. Okay. And how often should you do revaluation? If it is very volatile, annually. Otherwise, once in 3 to 5 years is good enough. Okay. All right. I've given you examples of separate class of assets. Okay. Revaluation gain. Sir, first time you did revaluation, and if you get a gain, that gain will go off to, it will be booked as a revaluation surplus, and that gain is a unrealized gain. So it will be shown in OCA. Okay. First time revaluation you did, and if you get a loss, first time only if you get a loss, then loss will straight away go off to PRL or SPL. Okay. Subsequent may if you get a gain, meaning, so first time you got a loss, then you got a gain. In that case, what you'll do? If first time you did a revaluation, you got a loss, then you got a gain. Then what you'll do? Gain, will you transfer it directly to revaluation surplus? No. Whatever loss first you have accounted earlier, that you will reverse, that you will set off. Balance gain only will be shown as revaluation surplus in OCA. Yes, no, we went through this as a land example, just have brought it. Okay. Then first time you did revaluation, you got a gain, then you got a loss. Will you transfer this subsequent loss to straight away to SPL? No. First time, whatever gain, no, you are parked in revaluation surplus. Adjust to the loss with revaluation surplus first. Balance loss, if it still remains, that you transfer it off to PRL or SPL. Okay. Is this making sense? What word is I have written here, everybody? This is a land example. I've tried to express it. It's easier to do through as an example, but I thought on the last day, you may not have time to do all the questions. So I've tried to express this in words also. But it is better understood with numbers. Okay. Then, accounting for revaluation gain. Sir, that depends. If it is a depreciable asset, and if you have followed provision for depreciation method, because there are two methods to account depreciation, charge method, provision method. Charge method, the journal entry for depreciation is depreciation account debit to PPE. So, since the depreciation is directly credited to PPE, PPE is already shown at carrying amount. So, that means this accounting you can follow, straightforward accounting you can follow. However, if provision for depreciation method is maintained, then revaluation comes. Then there are two options I had told you. First option is what? Whatever accumulated depreciation or provision for depreciation is there, that you reverse. The reversal entry is provision for depreciation account debit or accumulated depreciation account debit to PP. When you do this particular entry, PP ledger balance will be brought to carrying amount. Then compare this carrying amount with fair value. See whether it is a revaluation gain or loss. If it is a gain, the journal entry will be PPE account debit to revaluation reserve. Okay, this revaluation reserve will get reflected under OCA. This is one method. Second method is find out the percentage increase. Compare carrying amount with fair value and find out the percentage increase. You increase original cost also by that percentage. Accumulated depreciation also you increase by that percentage. So the journal entry will be PPE account debit to accumulated depreciation account. Journal entry will not match. The balancing figure will be nothing but your revaluation surplus. So I told you follow option number one for examination. So that will be a lot easier. Okay. All right. So due to depreciation, carrying amount will change. So depreciation also will change. Okay. And due to revaluation, if you are getting any excess depreciation, then company has a choice. What choice? To set off this excess depreciation with revaluation reserve. This adjustment, will you do it in SPL or you will do it in SOC? All this adjustment directly will be done SOC. What is the journal entry you will pass for this? Revaluation reserve or revaluation surplus account debit to retained earnings account. Okay, this adjustment you can do. This is an option with the company. If they want, they can do it, or if they want, they can choose not to do it. Okay, then all right, if you sell any property, plant and equipment. Okay, in fact, the 1 minute I had told you. In fact, sir, revaluation reserve is required as long as you have the asset. Revaluation reserve is required as long as you have the asset. If you derecognize the asset, doesn't matter whether the derecognition has come through sale, write-off, web stops, it doesn't matter. If asset is derecognized, then any balance in revaluation reserve will be transferred off to retained earnings that we had discussed. Yes. Okay. Then if you have, all right, that is okay. Then if PPE is held for sale, then IND AS 105 will get triggered. So revaluation and all will not come. I've given the frequency of revaluation here. Okay. When will you derecognize PPE? You'll derecognize PPE on disposal or if FEB stops. On derecognition, there could be a possibility that you made, if you sold the asset, probably you could have made some profit or loss. That profit or loss will go off to SPL or PRL. Okay. Then I've given some disclosure element. I told few disclosures you remember. One easy way is revaluation adjustment. Date of revaluation. Who did this revaluation? What is his assumption? What did you get? Did you get revaluation gain or revaluation loss? Okay, that is one. And depreciation method that you have selected. Useful life that you have estimated. These six. Impairment loss recognized. Impairment loss reversed. So few, 7 or 8 things you remember. Whatever a disclosure. Okay, that's good enough. Disclosure is not that important from examination. Okay, this was a quick recap of IND AS 60. Okay, if you remember, we took about almost 3.5 days to complete the topic, but it took about roughly only 20 minutes to revise the entire topic. That is the reason on the day one I told, with the help of chartbook, easily it will be possible for you to revise the entire concept within 5 to 6 hours. Okay, hope this session was helpful to you. Thank you so much. Bye.